Well, a lot of characters in different stories are actual people that I met or I've heard of, like the gynecologist in the embodiment. I actually had an ovarian cyst when I was 28, and my period wouldn't stop. And later I found out that it's very common among young women, and some people don't get their periods, and some people, like me, can't stop bleeding. So the symptoms vary, but it's a very common disease. And my gynecologist was very kind. She was very nice to me, for the record. But I thought, because she was nice and she was kind to me, I thought maybe I should make her really scary. Because, you know, hospitals are scary. And the guy who reads Shakespeare in broken English, this actually happened to my aunt's friend. When my aunt was young, one of her friends had a stalker, but they didn't have the word stalker back then. And back then, nobody had a cell phone. So this guy would like call her at home in the evenings and read Shakespeare in broken English for days on end. So, yeah, that guy actually exists. So, like, reality is weirder. Real people are weirder than characters in any story.
Wow, I think I really feel that joy when I read your book, because I hadn't...
You too?
I do! I feel... And I think maybe that comes through in the humor and the play and in that freedom. So I guess I want to... You know, you're naturally a very funny person. The book is very funny. How do you go sort of inserting these... It's almost... I don't know if it's not a comedic release, but how does humor play out in your writing process?
You either laugh or you cry and die.
And, you know, there's a lot of crying and dying in the book as well.
Yeah. I guess they failed to laugh. Sorry.
Thinking again about, you know, your work in translation, how does reading writers in Polish or Russian and then writing yourself in Korean, how do you think it changes your writing? I guess following on from that, besides just, you know, the joy and that freedom, you know, does the sort of, obviously the story structure or the language choices, how does that impact your writing? And do you potentially see the act of writing itself as an act of translation at all?
The last question I can answer readily, yes, because I wrote a 1.5 research paper. So yeah, I co-authored a research paper on that topic, and then I wrote a research paper on that separate topic. So yeah, the answer is yes. And it's not just me saying it, it's Yuri Lotman and Julia Kristeva and all the other big names say the same thing, that language, the act of speech and the act of writing are all acts of translation. You're translating your own thoughts into language, whether it's your mother tongue or something else. Genre fiction is what I discovered while studying Russian literature too, like Nikolai Gogol and his nose and his overcoat, all of his absurd and funny stories. And these are like typical genre fiction. Somebody wakes up without his nose in the morning, and a guy who, this government official, very low ranking government official, is obsessed with getting a new coat, and then he dies, and then he comes back as a ghost to like rob people of their overcoats. And these stories are taught in every single Russian literature class as one of the classics, of one of the best stories of Russian literature, the highest point of Russian literature, the Golden Age. And I truly, genuinely enjoyed them. And I found out that I could write these stories. These stories could be really good, like horror and fantasy and imaginative, speculative fiction, whatever you label it. They could be very useful tools for making a really good story. And Russians seem to think, Slavic people seem to not differentiate that sternly between realism and non-realistic stories. So, like, because it's somebody's imagination, you know, whatever happens, it's somebody's made up the story, so whatever goes on, it's from that person's imagination. So why does it have to stick to reality? I like that kind of thinking.